see if there were some more ladies that came in. I was kind of watching the kids come in and out because they know that I'm talking to you this afternoon. And we ran some ran by. we talked about what we're talking about here now. We talked together in class about it. And with the kiddos, there's three different levels. There's the seventh grade maturity, eighth grade maturity, and the high school maturity. So it was interesting to get their input about what we're going to talk about today. And I don't know that we really decided what I was talking about today. I'll give you what she said to me.
Our child's potential.
Child's potential.
You know, also what we feel, our expectations and what we assume that the Lord has a better plan for them, but it also has to do with how the Lord wants us to raise our children according to His word. You put me on.
Let's play the communication game because that's not what I thought I got from
that.
All right, if you were in seventh or eighth grade right now, you would be feeling very uncertain about things because it doesn't sound like the leadership is certain about what's going on. However, I'll give you the backstory. Last fall, we went to a ladies' conference. Good Shepherd put it together. Viola sees things a wonder. It was wonderful. Didn't you go to that? Wasn't it good? And there we are at the table, and the ground is kind of level, meaning that Melody was also at the table with us. And
I'm done.
All right. So this is annoying, but this morning they've been working on the parking lot out back, and the walls shook, my screen shook, the papers on my desk shook, and it was, the kids said it was like a helicopter hovering. It was loud. So this is manageable, just to say. So here we are, back to Melody at the table. And Chris Mara's going. Taking in this back and forth, especially between Melody and myself. And what she said to me, what Chris Mara said to me, is that it seemed that Melody knew where the boundaries were drawn, and she seemed to know, because Melody Melody has a smart alecky sense of humor. Are your kids like that? Do they have a smart alecky sense of humor? But Chris Mara was picking up on, all Melody had to do was look at Mom and knew where the lines were drawn. Now, I don't remember making any reaction at all, but there must have been some sensitivity there. Are our children sensitive?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I can hope for that, because you know, you send your children to me for English, and I talk to them, I interact with them. It was crazy today. We had three good interactions about what I'm gonna talk with you about. It went in different directions, but all of it was, all of it had merit, it had value, and I was pleased with all three levels of maturity. I was very pleased. Somebody out there is doing their job. You're doing your job. Thank you. But your kids were never a problem. Never. So, what I took from it, yes.
That's right. Now I'm sorry. So many speakers. When we went to the women's retreat, Mrs. Semple and Melody have a relationship that I was admiring when they were sitting at that table. Because Melody's a jokester, and she would poke fun at her mom, but she knew when to draw back. She knew when Mom wasn't liking it, she was quick to move. But then Mom would play, and then they would banter together, and I said that I admired the fact that her daughter knew the difference between when the mother was disciplining me and was not okay with something, but knew when I
mentioned one thing I think is important, and that's a relationship with the children, which, interestingly enough, I'm trying to cultivate now with the 7th grade level, the 8th grade level, the high school level, cultivating a relationship with them. Because doesn't Proverbs say the sweetness of the lips increases learning? I don't do it to that end. I just like them. I like to hear what they have to say. I like having those kids in my life. Natalie's very sweet. But as far as my children, I have to say that, and you're going to say, well, of course you would say this, you're the pastor's wife, but I would have to say it's God working in them because they have gone way beyond our expectations, way beyond. So I'm saying if he was willing to do that for us, he certainly is willing to do it for all of us. And I think, again, that's motivation for me with the 7th grade, 8th grade, and the high school kids to keep talking to them, not to short-sight themselves about what's available to them and where they could go, what they should be open to. And they are. And so I keep talking to them. But I wondered if Chris Meyer didn't mean respect. Where did Melody's respect for me come from? And I'm thinking, all right, here's what I'm thinking. In my background, my mother was not a relationship-oriented kind of person. She was a go-getter, not a relationship-oriented person. And her mother, my mother was born the December following the economic fall of 1929. And it was hard for her mother. Her husband had just died. She had 6 kids. There were no government programs. And their generation just generally said children are to be seen and not heard. And my mother was busy and had that mentality with her as well. Children are to be seen and not heard. But I thought, there's got to be more to life than this. I really wanted a relationship with our children. I was glad when Stephen was the first boy. My brothers minded that I was the first. And not that we, you know, I wasn't bossy. We had, on the farm, we had different jobs to do. I didn't really encounter my brothers. They had their jobs. I had my place to be. There wasn't a reason for them to feel bothered by my being there. So I was always curious about that. Of course, now we're adults and I could probably ask them about it. Anyway, I felt like having a relationship. I felt like I missed a lot by not having a family relationship. My mom and dad were tight. They had a good marriage. In fact, my mother was led to the Lord by her bookkeeping teacher in high school. And when she was involved with a Christian group at the Methodist Church, the same one my dad went to, my dad said, she's the one. And they got married and off they went. Very happy marriage. However, it didn't really seem to involve us, and I always felt that void, so that I wanted a relationship. And then was called into teaching, and it meant, you know, being with children, and you either love them or you leave them. If you can't abide by children and work with them, it's not a comfortable place to be. So I started working with them, and it was enjoyable. So that when our children came along, it just seemed like the thing to do, to work with them and develop their talents, because I felt like developing your talents was beneficial. It gave you a sense of worth. It gave you opportunities. And Stephen had music lessons, but the girls were the ones that took off with piano playing. Yes, Melody plays the piano. So that I was interested in them developing their talent. So you're probably wondering, well, what is this paper for anyway? I'll tell you what it's for. In the high school classes or otherwise, I like to give them notes, but I have found that they go right to filling in the blanks. That's my job, I fill in the blanks, and they don't capture the other things that are being said. They don't get the whole picture. It's like one and done. When I'm done, I can go on to something else. So I'm leaving the paper blank for you to use to take notes. I want talk about reverence and respect. And I want to put that in front of you because in our culture, there isn't that sense of respect. There isn't that sense of dignity or value. And I want to tell you about my dad. So my husband and I are married. We go back and visit my parents, and my husband is noticing that my dad kind of struggles to get up when my husband comes in the room, and he's not making sense of that. But this is the kind of guy my dad is. Eventually, my dad says, "I'm trying to get up out of honor." And my husband said, "But you don't need to do that. You know, you're dad. I should be honoring you." This conversation actually happened. And he said, "No, I am respecting your position as a pastor." So that, I'm going to put that in front of you. And just to think about what other places should we be showing honor and respect. So just now I was coming across, and the kids know, you drive on the right side. You're supposed to drive on the right side of the hallway so that everybody can get to where they're going. However, ahead of class, just this morning, eighth grade boy stood out in the hallway. He knew nothing about what I was going to talk about. He waited in the hallway until I went in the room. Even though I had said, okay, girls go in, boys you can go in. He waited for me to go in. Does that signal anything to you? And I was just so pleased for him. But you know what, eighth grade boys don't want attention drawn to them, so I couldn't really say anything about how pleased I was because they don't want that attention drawn to them. But you know, it starts somewhere. It starts where we're at. What ways do you show a sense of reverence? And what I'm getting at is whatever you model, whatever's important to you becomes evident in your children. And sometimes our children are just completely opposite of our temperament or what we're about, but they may be all about what your husband is about. And tell me what you think about this. I have noticed a pattern where the oldest daughter favors the dad and the oldest son favors the mom. You're at that age and are working with your children, so have you seen that among your kids? You're looking at me funny, like...
Yes, big time.
Thank you. What about you, Rachel?
Personality?
Are you talking about personality or like...
It could be personality.
Personality.
Actions, reactions.
In my family, that's true with me. Of course, I'm the only girl, but yes, I favor my dad. And my brothers were more my mother.
All right, then likely... Go ahead.
So, yes, I would say that's true in my family. In my own children, everybody's got mom. So, right now, so not that it won't change, but they're very much
mom. Speaking of mom, she said she was going to be here. Maybe she's on her way. Your mom.
My mom? I think she's with the children.
She's with the kids.
Okay. She said she was on her way to Jen's, and I said, well, I'll see you then.
Oh, well, she's in Jules.
All right. Okay. Right. You're an interesting example because you have three girls.
Yes, well, no. I think Lucy still is very much patterning after me at this point. But I wonder too, as I get older, if things, you know, that it shifts a little bit. So that when you look at your adult kids, it's like, oh yes, personality is very much like dad.
I have four girls, and they're situational based. It just depends on what's going on. It's Okay. We prefer to be with dads, but just how they act and react is just depends on dads.
All right. I just wondered. For instance, are there certain lines that you draw where things are appropriate and not appropriate? All right, then I'll give you an example of my own. So we have a son, we have two daughters, we're in church together, the pastor is preaching, I have a girl on each side, and Stephen decides to get up on the pew and run the length of the pew during the service and come back. And I can't get to him because I have a girl on each side. Appropriate or not appropriate?
Depends
not appropriate, but there's not much you could either do about it when you got two kids on each side. I mean, you can tell them to sit down.
And that's true enough. That's true enough. Our society is a little bit more fluid than it was 30 years ago when he was running the pews. And so it was a little bit disruptive in the service. It was an older crowd, and you know, I was embarrassed to death. So have your kids embarrassed you?
Uh-huh.
All right, Mrs. Hunter, tell us about the time your kids embarrassed you. Church? Are you in church? Were you in church on Sunday? And they say no, and I'm thinking, I feel very sorry for that, because one of those kids lives where he can see his church from home, but his parents aren't interested in going to church, although they tell you they were Christians. And I'm thinking, where is the hunger and thirst for righteousness? All right. Next point. So we need to be respectful. We need to be appropriate. What are you enthusiastic about? Because whatever you're enthusiastic about, your kids will be enthusiastic about. Where you draw the lines, your kids will draw the lines. Why do they do that? Because they're unsure sometimes where to draw the lines, and they see it. They see it working for you, Carrie. So it must be good. It must be good for them too. So, do you have something that you're enthusiastic about that you see your kids are picking up with? Or do you see them? What's yours, Rachel?
So, I really enjoy gardening and planting, and so I'm learning that my kids, if I tell them in gardening, they're developing an interest in gardening.
Very good example. Mm-hmm. I tried it with garage sailing. Because I'm motivated to economize. They are not motivated to economize. They are not. They are not motivated to economize. They also don't want clutter at their houses.
But they were really yours.
Well, I use my clutter, so it's justified. Really, and really, I can be truthful about that because I like to see things nice in the ladies' restroom. Guess where I draw from? My inventory. It's not clutter anymore. It's right? Inventory.
I know. It's pretty always in there.
So that was a very good example. Do any of the rest of you have something like that? What?
I enjoy reading, and my 6-year-old is starting to read now, so now that she can read, you know, little books and stuff, she wants to read to other girls and to younger siblings until she can read like mommy. And so now we have like these special times in the afternoon where we'll sit and just read. She may not know she's reading all the time, but she's at least spending time with me reading. So.
And both of those are important, time with you and the reading. I'm a little jealous. Would you be my mommy?
Yes.
Just kidding. So I have another thought for you. And it just escaped me. I guess this is where I know I'm old and thoughts escape me. It's not coming back to me, so we'll go on to the next thing. So in Deuteronomy chapter 6. Oh, I know what it was. Remember I told you about my dad standing up for the pastor when he came in? Leviticus chapter 19, verse 32, "Rise, thou shalt rise up before the hoary head and honor the face of the old man and fear thy God." I'm wondering if my dad got it from this verse.
Leviticus what?
1932. So standing. However, go to Deuteronomy, please. And you're very familiar with the verses in Proverbs 22, verse 6. It says, "Train up a child in the way he should go. When he's old, he'll not depart from it." That's very true. As I was talking about this with another lady, she said, "But didn't Hitler say, if you give me your kid for the first 5 years of his life?" Was it you that told me that, Rachel?
Yeah, but I did.
"If you give me your kid for the first 5 years of his life, then you'll be sold on whatever I send you in." Deuteronomy 5. Okay. Still in Leviticus. Right, I do know how to get there. Deuteronomy 5. Oh, that there was, and I'm going to talk about God, God's place in their life. "Oh, that there was such a heart in them that they would fear me, that they would respect me." Do you need a verse there? It's Deuteronomy 5:29. Deuteronomy 5:29. "Oh, that there was such a heart in them. Oh, I long for this. I'm not a God that's far away. I'm a God that's close. Oh, that there was such a heart in them that they would fear me, that they would respect me and keep all my commandments always." Why? Does he want that because he's self-indulged God, an ego God? Oh, it says right here that it might be well with them and their children forever. I'm going to back up to the generation above me. That would be my mom and dad. When my mom got saved, she was 110% moving forward with whatever the Bible said, what God said was the way it was. She had enthusiasm for whatever God said was the way it was. She was enthusiastic. She wanted to be in church, and so did my dad. But my dad came out of a Methodist church where they were getting ready to baptize babies, and my dad said, "It doesn't make a lot of sense. If the baby can't make a decision that he wants to be saved, what is the point of baptizing the baby?" So we came out of the Methodist church, went up the hill to the Baptist church, and there was a wonderful pastor there. And then the convention called him away, and then, oh, we're back at ground zero with no place that would teach us and feed us. Hungry and thirsty, but nowhere to go. A man came, it was Grant Rice. And you have a connection with Grant Rice by way of your husband. Remember he mentioned Grant Rice Sunday night. I want to catch up with him and ask him what his connection is. Grant Rice was a church planter in Wisconsin. And he came to Monroe, and when my parents heard about him, they were off to Monroe. And they were faithful there, and the church grew. And another pastor came, and when that church was taken care of, then my parents went the other way. They went to Broadhead and started a church plant. Now, they didn't start it. A man came, and they helped support what was going on and get a church going. So then, my parents have been enthusiastic for God. It wasn't drudgery. Whenever there was a service, whether, you know, the milking was already done, the chores were already done, and we were in the car and we were there for the church service. Sunday morning, Sunday evening, Wednesday night, special meetings every night. And if there was a cow having a calf, if a cow was having a calf, typically dad didn't need to be there, but if he was there, everybody else went on, they were at church. That's the kind of enthusiasm my parents had. So that, do you think that example, what my parents modeled, had a good effect on the rest of us? Yes, I just thought it was the way things were, and I didn't have my eyes closed, I didn't have blinders on. However, I didn't like the small, I didn't ever have a youth group situation. I didn't have that kind of fellowship. When my brothers were old enough, it was myself and my two brothers, and I really missed that. And we didn't have strong teaching because most of the people who came needed the simpler teaching. So that when I went to Bible college, the teachers would say, "No, I know you learned this in Sunday school," and I'd go, "Whoa, what? I didn't learn that in Sunday school. How far behind am I?" So that, you know, I wanted to be a part of a bigger church. But anymore, you know, it doesn't matter to me because I've known what it is to have God involved in the church and God working in the church, and that's a wonderful thing. The only way I can explain our children is that God was working in them, and I'm so glad. I'm so glad for that because they're far beyond either my husband or myself. So that, do you have any stories to tell in that way where God has been good? God has been working on your behalf?
Mrs. Wong here at church has been helping out with my daughter in California. And yesterday I gave a speech to her, and her phone number, and you know, she was like living in our house, and I had to go to the doctor. But when I was outside, after seeing the doctor, she walked by. I was like, "Hi, I need to talk to you." So it was great when God intervened.
And those interventions are wonderful too, when you say, only God could have done that, only God.
Only you.
All right, so I want to circle back to you having a relationship to your children, because that comes up in chapter 6, Deuteronomy 6. And what does God want from us? God wants us to fear the Lord, to keep all his statutes, his commandments, which I command thee, thou and thy son, and thy son's sons. Could I say something about the son's sons? So that in having a relationship with our children, and having a relationship with all the children that I happen to be among, it just makes sense that I would want that relationship with my grandchildren. So that the outcome of that is that when their dad says they're going to Indiana, the grandkids think Indiana's the best place on earth. I mean, they jump up and down and they're so excited, and I'm thinking, hey, here we are, we get to see Indiana every day. And it just brings them a lot of happiness, a lot of joy. All right, going on. So there's our sons, all the days of your life. It can happen all of the days of your life, that thy days may be prolonged. Hear therefore, O Israel, and observe to do it. Hear, O gems, ladies, and help to observe to do it, that it may be well with thee. Do we want that? Yes. We want that, yes, we want it to be well, that ye may increase mightily. I felt like for being in the classroom that I've increased mightily because those kids have been something special. And yes, they have deficiencies, and yes, there's things to work through, but it's interesting to me when they see me in the hallway. I'm sure this is an Indiana thing. When they see me in the hallway, they're waving, "Hey, hi. Glad to see you," even just now when they went upstairs and when they came down. And that's something they initiated. They started doing the high thing. Then it may, that you may increase mightily as the Lord God of the fathers hath promised thee in the land that floweth with milk and honey. I'm starting to think Indiana flows with milk and honey. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord. thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart, because when you love the Lord with all your heart, to go down to verse 7, you'll teach those things diligently to your children, because you'll know how sweet the Lord is, and you'll want them to have that sweetness also. And you'll talk about those things when you sit in your house, and you'll talk about them when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you're in the classroom, and when you're in the car, and when you're in Walmart. There's nobody that makes Walmart a mission field quite like Debbie Parker. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Yes, she is something else. And Paul is like that too. If they see somebody they know, they make a beeline and talk. And I'm in my mind, sniggling in my mind, is somebody that was led to the Lord in Walmart. And I'm not placing that time to tell you specifically, because it only just now jumped in my head. So that you're making there a relationship, and the Lord is involved, he's being lifted up, even as you walk, even as you lie down, and when you rise up. It's all the time, because it's real to you. And when it's real to you, it becomes real to your children, because who knows you better than your children? And they know what's real and what's not real with you. They know when you really mean something, and they know when they can push the boundaries. Right. So what are you going to go home and do? Yes, absolutely. Those conversations that we had this morning in the classroom were just very good, and I'll go home and think about them. And my impression was, God is so good. God is so good. Even though they're working on this parking lot back here, do you know the classroom's downstairs? Did you get the shaking and the vibration? I was sitting at my desk and the screen was shaking. The kid said, it's like a helicopter.
I used to live over an airport. Where like the airplanes would fly over all day long. And it was so awful. I mean, I got used to it, but I don't know. It was
annoying. You still live there now?
No.
You know what? I'm thinking about my kids. If they had the opportunity, they like to go to the airport, and they would lay in the grass at the end of the runway.
That's interesting. That would be cool.
Would you let your kids do that?
I don't know.
All right, I won't tell them.
I think there's too many fences now.
Fence it, well, yeah, and that's the society and culture we live in. Right, do you have any input? You all, do you have any input, any thoughts? Right, if I could leave you with one thing, it would be to lift up the Lord and be enthusiastic for his sake. The Lord has done great things for us, where we are glad. Dear Lord, thank you for moms, grandmoms everywhere. Thank you. Thank you for the encounters we've had even today, where you've been.